idea was just to bring people together, and I strongly believe in networking and also meeting people face to face. You build relationship, you build trust, which is quite important, especially for finance. But we didn't want to just talk about finance. It's a boring subject. So that's why we got Patrick with us. So he's going to talk about his art. Also, I just want to mention a couple of other things. I think most of you know I actually want to create a Turkish technology network, which is in progress at the moment. We want to do the same thing we do with the Turkish finance, bring people together and help them with their experience and knowledge. So that's upcoming event, hopefully. And for the ladies, happy Women's Day as well. So I introduced Patrick to you, and he's going to talk about his art, which I think is going to be very interesting for finance guys, especially different view of finance. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much. It's, first of all, it's a pleasure to be here and to be able to talk about art in general, especially about the painting that you see behind you, which is called The Temple of Mars, The Avenger, Templo Marti Urbis in Latin. The temple itself is the temple that Augustus, Emperor Augustus, decided to build after he defeated the people who had assassinated Julius Caesar at the Battle of Philippi on the 23rd of October, 42 BC. But it took 40 years for the temple to be built. So finally, on the 23rd of October of the year 2 BC, the temple was inaugurated. And this painting is not only a painting, it is actually a time machine. Because I want you to imagine that you are there on the 23rd of October, 2 BC. And you have the cornices playing the music and the big parade of all the Roman dignitaries walking down the street, the forum, to come to the temple dedication. It is a warm afternoon. The haruspex, the priests, are already there on the steps of the temple. Augustus is coming with his Praetorian Guard, and all the generals of the empire are with him. And the priest will start the incantation to Mars, the Father, please give us your goodness and bless our families and our homes. And as he does this, he takes the sacred knife and will sacrifice the bull to the god of war, to Mars. This temple will become the center of business in Rome, on the Forum, for 120 years, until it was replaced by another stock exchange that Hadrian put together. This was the center of finance in Rome. This is where the business deals took place for equipment for the army. This is where the commanders came to be blessed before they went into campaigns and into war. Because the Romans had already associated the business of weapons and war with the business of finance. And this was actually the original stock exchange in Rome. So this temple is the representation of what the temple looked like. It has six columns because you need to be able to go in, so the temples never have an odd number of columns. And what I show here is the continuation of history. We still have a Temple of Mars. It is not a building itself. It is these institutions in which we conduct business to sell weapons, to sell war. Because men are addicted to war. Homer, in the Iliad, states, men would rather get tired of making love than making war. And we continue today with our constant wars in the Middle East, in Africa, in Asia, wherever it is. And we are all living under the threat of nuclear weapons. So the colors of the temple have been turned into intercontinental ballistic missiles. Russian, French, American, even Germans, because they're the first ones who actually have invented this type of weapon. And in the middle here, you have the aspiration of the Islamic world to become a world power, to develop weapons to the same scales as the West. But right now, the only thing that is taking off is a minaret, because I was talking to one of you before, yeah, and you know, he told me when I was a little boy, I thought the minarets were all rockets. Okay, and actually, I depict this in the painting as well. And who is on the painting? So at the top, you have Achilles dying. You have Proserpina, the queen of the Amazon, also dying in combat, because we always have this glorification of people who die in combat. You die with honor. Then you have the Nazis killing the Jews. We have ISIS killing fighters and beheading them. But all of this is possible only because in the West, and by the West I mean the people who live in the Western countries of Europe and North America, we have glorified war, and we have taken advantage of the ability to wage war, to conquer and to destroy civilizations. So on the right hand side of the temple, you have Christopher Columbus, who is glorified as the discoverer of America, but actually is a mass murderer. The King of Spain himself knew that. And they recalled Columbus and put him in jail so he could explain himself why he was killing all the American Indians. On the other side, you have Bernard Arlish, a non-war criminal who was assassinated by the English, but who invented the final solution for the Jews. What difference, I'm asking, in this painting is there between the two? Okay, so here also we have a portrait of Lenin, which links this genocide across the ideologies. And the flag says Lenin has lived, because nobody would claim to be a proponent of his ideas today. But being a proponent of capitalism and the exchange of money that allows weapons to be built and sold and exploited and killing people, that is perfectly acceptable. In the temple, you see that the doors are made of gold, and the door does not have a lock. The reason the door does not have a lock is because in order to be able to conduct business in the temple of Mars, you have to be accepted. You have to be part of the clan. You have to be part of the gangs that sell weapons. And inside the temple, you can see that there is a yellow light. So there's something going on in the temple. There's some type of trade going on. But you will not know. You will not be accepted. We are outsiders. And the only thing we can do is look at what is going on, at what war does, at the threats that we have upon us by nuclear weapons, and we cannot do anything about it. So, who are we? We are the people who are now going into the underworld. We are the people who are sacrificed to war, to weaponry, and to the military industrial complex. We are walking into this gate, which is actually the same gate as Auschwitz, but I replaced the writing by Lasciate ogni speranza, which means leave hope behind, which is the motto that is written on the entrance to hell and in Dante Alighieri's Divine Comedy. When he goes into hell, he says, "You enter here, leave any hope behind." And we are the ones who are going into the underworld, because there's no hope for us to be able to change this, because there's so much money exchanging hands all the time that you and I cannot possibly change it. So the shadows going into the underworld are so desperate. It is like when Ulysses goes and visit with Achilles in hell, well, the underworld, because the Greeks don't believe in hell, they believe in the other world. And he says to Achilles, "You are the prince down here. You are the hero of the Greeks. You are the greatest warrior who ever lived." And Achilles tells him, "No, there are no heroes down here. There are only gray shadows who are dying of boredom." And this is where we are going. We are being led into this world where we are completely helpless and we are only shadows because we have no power to stop what is going on. One, a couple of more things. I have the flag of ISIS, but if you look at it correctly, you will see that it does not say what you would say you would expect to find on the flag of ISIS. And of course you have the drone, because today when we have a problem, how do we solve it? We bomb something. There is a tourist attack in Paris. What do the French do? They send an aircraft carrier to Syria and bomb somebody. They don't care who it is, but they do something about it. So this is how we have been trained to accept that the solution to everything is violence and the deployment of war and methods of killing people. I have a brochure on the tables. You are welcome to take it and to look at it. I also have other paintings upstairs. Okay, they are in the same style, which is the style of Faurism, which paintings have three levels of understanding. The first one is you have the aesthetics of the painting, where you look at it, if you like it or not. The second part is that you have figures that you recognize in the painting. For example, you recognize Christopher Columbus, you may recognize Lenin and Reinhard Heydrich, you may recognize Achilles. So that's the second layer where you can interpret some of the elements of the painting. And the third layer is the one I brought together to you, where I explain to you the entire painting and what the philosophy is behind the painting. Okay?
Thank you.